You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV Guidance Counselor. This is a very special week. It is week two of my episodes from Los Angeles, and this week is a very, very fun guest. My guest this week is Nancy Valen. Nancy is a former actor as well as a producer. You may know her from Baywatch, or Hull High, or Saved by the Bell, or Friends. We talk about all of those here and more. She also recently just filmed an interview for an upcoming Baywatch documentary, which, if you know anything about me, which you probably do if you listen to the show, I am incredibly excited for this documentary. I always enjoy Baywatch. It is a show that comes up on this show often. I hope they cover Baywatch Nights, especially season two. We did discuss that with Alexandra Paul a year or two ago. So if you didn't know she was on the show, she was on the show. Maybe go back, check that out. Other Baywatch cast members we've had on the show are Christina Lease, Vanessa Angel. They were all in season one of Baywatch. But Nancy was in a later season, along with Yasmin Bleeth, who is one of her good friends. We talk about all that here and more. I couldn't be more happy with this episode. She is great, incredibly smart, funny, really great to talk to, and I think you will enjoy hearing me talk to her. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Nancy Valen.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Nancy Valen, how are you?
Hello. I'm so glad to be here. I have to say, when you first asked me to do this, I looked at the idea and I thought, that's just incredible. And
oh, thank you.
I definitely want to take part in that. So what a creative idea that you have.
Thank you. Yeah, it's funny. So many people that got into the entertainment industry, it's turns out that they were huge TV people or mm-hmm. movie people as kids. And so you have that in common with, there's a reason that they gravitated towards this world mm-hmm. in a lot of ways. So it's always funny to hear what they watched.
I really love the name.
Oh,
TV
thank
Guidance
you.
Guidance Counselor. Yeah. Because for me, I immediately related to that. I thought TV was my guidance counselor.
Oh, yeah.
Growing up.
That's how I learned. Because I think we were talking before and you were a fellow latchkey kid.
Yes.
But yeah, as someone who, you know, didn't have the most parental guidance, like that's how you learned about everything.
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, my mom was a teacher. So, you know, she would get home later than we got home. And I watched reruns, you know, every day when I got home. You know, we lived on the beach and it was beautiful, but I just loved TV.
Was it because it was so different from your experience, or it was just like a comforting thing, or you just love the stories?
I think so many aspects, you know. First of all, the story, I think it makes you feel more connected, mm-hmm. right? And it was educational in a lot of ways when I think about that. I really related when you said that,
yeah.
You know, that's how I found out a lot of my information. You know, one of my friends once said something silly one day and I just looked at her and I said, didn't you watch Sesame Street?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, you know.
Exactly. We all learned this. Yeah.
Even if I didn't listen in class, I watched Sesame Street. Yeah, I just love the story. I think the fantasy of it, for sure. And then my grandmother, you know, I lived in New York City and then I used to spend my summers there and she used to take us to a lot of Broadway shows.
That's amazing.
And that's when I first fell in love with the theater and I thought, oh, this looks so, I just, the fantasy of it, you know, I just wanted to live in that world.
Growing up in New York, I always wonder, because especially like in the 60s and 70s, before everything sort of shifted to being LA based.
Mm-hmm.
Every show and everything sort of gravitated around New York. And so there was this image of New York that probably wasn't necessarily accurate for people that lived there. But when you were going back to visit, were you like, this is the New York I've been watching and things, or did it feel totally different?
Well, I have to say, you know, in the late 60s and 70s, you know, it wasn't there was a lot of crime in New York. And yeah. my grandfather owned a hotel, the Hotel Belclair. It's still there on the Upper West Side, 77th and Broadway. And it was a bit of a rough neighborhood. And, you know, every summer I would go back through the years. We would always go back. And he sold it, I think, when I was about maybe 16 years old. Big mistake, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he was probably like, I got to cash out.
Millions of dollars. I know. He thought it was so much money at the time. You know, but I saw the transition of that area. You know, if you watch Mad Men, right, you can see one of the characters moves to the Upper West Side and she's in a brownstone. You know, you can see that. Or if you watch The Deuce, it's, you know, Maggie Gyllenhaal, right? Fantastic. They did such a good job at capturing
that
42nd Street at that time, the garbage in the streets, just everywhere. But it still had everything wonderful, you know, what the city was.
Yeah.
You just navigated around that.
It was part of it. Like, you expected it.
Yeah, you know? you expected it.
Like, speaking of Sesame Street, which is one of my favorites ever, and I've told this on the show before, but in Queens, there's the Museum of the Moving Image.
Oh, and, I did not know that. My father still lives in Queens, so I'm going.
It's right. It's in Astoria, Queens, and it's right next to that, like, that only still working film studio they have there, which I think they do some of the soaps and game shows, but it's next door. It used to be a studio.
Is As the World Turns, or is that show still on? Another World?
So.
Which one is still on? One of those.
I think General Hospital still
General Hospital is still here. No, they've been here
They've been here for a while. Yeah. I think maybe not. One of them's still there. Mm-hmm. It's like the last holdout. But the other building they made into the Museum of the Moving Image, and they have a standing Jim Henson exhibit.
Oh.
And it has all of Henson's notes and the original puppets and like
beautiful.
All the Sesame. And the first time I went in there, I just started like welling up. Like, you know, it's a you're like, oh, what's happening? Because you're right there.
Whole childhood, right? Just flash in front of you.
This is crazy. But I always say like that show and like Mr. Rogers like made us all better people.
Mm-hmm.
But Sesame Street still had that grime. Like it was New York.
Yeah, it was the street.
Yeah, which was weird for a kids show.
Yes.
It even permeated the kids shows at
the
time.
Well, when Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, or you know, Mr. Rogers, it was just Mr. Rogers, right?
Yep.
Or was
it?
That just made me feel safe.
Yeah.
Is that how it was for you too?
Yeah, and he didn't.
It's calming.
Absolutely.
Did you watch the new?
The movie.
The movie.
I watched the documentary.
Yes.
Which is hard. Like just. But I haven't watched the Tom Hanks one yet. It's funny that I've on doing this show and I'm talking to people sort of our age and group generally, is there's this arc that we have with Mr. Rogers, where as a kid, you're like everything. You're just like, it feels comforting and calm and not talking down to you. And then as you get a little older, you get really cynical about it.
Oh, yeah. It's
you're
not
like,
cool.
You're like, creepies. What weirdo.
Yes.
And, you know, like you're the Eddie Murphy, Mr. Robinson's Neighborhood kind of like making fun of it.
Exactly. Yeah.
And then you reach a point where you're like, he was a genius. Like he just, it's that weird circle of life. You realize what he was doing. Mm-hmm. And it's, I don't know if they have stuff like that for kids now, but especially like the Latchkey kids, having an adult that was like, calming and safe, but not, he never lied to kids.
Mm-hmm.
Like they would cover a lot of things that were bad and he'd be honest about it and like tell you how to deal with it, which is now really shocking when I rewatched it, but it's great.
I don't know what's, I don't have children, so I don't know what's available but I really think that, you know, it's really wonderful to see that they did the movie.
Yeah.
You know,
people are
him.
Appreciating it now, I think, because he was a kind of a punchline for so many years.
Yeah, definitely.
Undeservedly. There's actually great footage of him on the old Letterman, the morning show. And it was in...
Letterman had a morning show?
Yeah, before the late night show.
Had no idea.
It was the one where, if you've ever seen footage of like Andy Kaufman getting slapped or like some of the more famous, that was all from the morning show. Because he was a fill-in weatherman, I think, on Good Morning.
Can you see that now?
Yeah, they're up on YouTube.
Okay.
But there's one where Fred Rogers is the guest. And as much as I love Letterman, he used to kind of do a thing where he'd book somebody and he'd kind of like make fun of them.
Gives him hell, yeah.
And Rogers is like not taking it, but knows what he's doing. So, so he brings up the Eddie Murphy, Mr. Robinson neighborhood thing, thinking Fred Rogers would be really offended by it. And he's like, no, we're in studio. We're at 30 Rock. I went and said hello to him. And there's a picture of him and Eddie Murphy. And he's like, I think it's pretty funny. And Letterman doesn't know how to deal with it because he was like, I was not expecting him to have a sense of humor about it.
He kind of wanted
to
fight.
Yeah, he knows what he's doing. But New York, to me, when I always think of like, what's my line? And like those really 50s, like weird intellectual, you know, Gore Vidal on things. Mm-hmm. And by the 70s, I just think of like the Warriors and Barney Miller.
Barney Miller, one of my favorites.
Which
I love
think
that
you picked
show.
On the list
yes,
but
yes.
That is what I think of New York must have actually been like in the 70s. That seems accurate.
Gosh, I was so little, you know? So I just remembered, you know, the museums and the parks and I loved it there. It was just, it was exciting. School was fun. It's what I know.
Yeah,
it's what
absolutely.
I knew, you know, delis and Carvel ice cream on the way home from school.
Having Fonzie the whale for your birthday.
Getting a, you know, a slice of pizza, you know, at the, it was great just to have everything accessible.
Right.
In New York, you could go home for school. Even when I was in second grade, usually someone would pick us up. But I remember one day, you know, my girlfriend told her parents, you did that little switch thing. I told my, and we went out to lunch on our own at 7.
Yeah.
You know, and you could do that there because you didn't need a car.
Yeah. And people were totally used to it. So 2 7-year-olds, you're like,
yeah,
they're like, fine.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah. It's all good.
Because then you moved to Florida. What part of Florida were you in?
South Florida.
Okay.
So my grandparents, it was their dream to retire there. So we headed down there a bit before they did. And that was so great too, to have those, you know, to become a teenager and start dating.
Yes.
You know, with the
and
beautiful
the beach
and the humidity and the warm nights.
It's like Gidget.
So it was good. I wasn't a Gidget fan, so I don't know, but I get a lot of you look like Sally Field.
Oh, yeah, I can see that.
I do get that.
That wouldn't be my first guess, but I could see that now that you mention it.
It's the most consistent one that I've gotten through the years.
Everyone has one of those.
Yeah.
I think that's like, this
weird.
Is the one.
Do you have anyone?
I used to get Bruce Campbell. He was in... He was on Ellen, and he was on the show Burn Notice, and was like, he does a lot of horror movies.
Burn Notice?
Yeah, that was a USA.
It was for a minute, right?
Yeah, it was a Florida show, actually.
Yes.
They shot in Miami.
Yeah.
It was a cool show. It was like A-Team, basically.
Mm-hmm.
I had Matt Nixon, who created that show. That was an interesting chat about how his story approached. But I can't think of two more different places than Manhattan and South Florida, probably in that time. And I imagine it's like sort of a culture shock.
It was culture shock. I mean, it took me about a quick second to get used to the weather and wanting to go in the water and all of that. You know, I absolutely loved it. It was so much fun.
Right.
I just remember looking out at the pool and the beach and going, we want to go.
You can do this all the time.
Yeah. It's so exciting. But what was culture shock was the school situation was very different.
Okay.
I was in some sort of creative study at my New York school. They were just kind of more hip and maybe more liberal. I don't know. But, you know, my mom signed off for my public school in New York that I could have creative study, which meant basically that we could have class wherever we felt like it.
Right.
So if we wanted to sit in the hall and do our work, we could do that.
It's independent learning.
It was. And I remember changing classes in second grade. You know, running up and down the stairs, you know.
Changing my major.
Yeah. It was just a different experience. And then when I got into the school in Florida, we were walking in a straight line and there were all these rules. And that was very unsettling to me. And
it's militaristic.
Yeah, kids were being punished. Like, I remember, you know, I don't know what I was doing. I was probably talking too much or something. You know, go stand in the corner. And I thought, my mother, I had no rules growing up.
Yeah.
So this was just, you know, somebody punished me. And I thought, what am I doing looking into this corner? Like, this is crazy. And I just thought, this place is like, it's
like a prison.
Yeah. I just didn't get it. It scared me, you know, because of all those rules. And I will never forget this. My mom took me to go register. It's totally off topic. My mom took me to register, you know, for school. And they said to her, we paddle at this school. And if you don't want your, my mother said, oh no.
Yeah.
You know, and he said, well, if you don't want your daughter paddled, then you have to say no to corporal punishment. And I just remember feeling horrified because we were never, ever hit. And I know, you know, still there's a lot of people that, you know, there's big controversy about that, but we are still like one of the only countries, you know, that paddles. All of Europe does not. Israel does not.
Yeah.
And I think it's like us and Saudi Arabia. It's like very few.
Good company there.
You know, it's like very, very few places. And I've asked people, I'm like, no, I think that that's good. I'm like, oh my God.
I just think it's
absolutely insane.
It sounds completely insane to me as well. And I'm just like, what?
Yeah.
But it's, and it points to the fact that America is so enormous and it's like a bunch of different countries. And, you know, when I lived in the UK or have friends from Europe, they don't quite get that. It's vastly different because they kind of assume everything's sort of similar.
Yeah, the culture is completely different.
I'm like, no,
where you're from.
Yeah,
100%.
And that is a prime example because that is an extreme difference. And at that time, I think probably Florida, the only thing I could imagine was like Flipper. It was like my only experience in Florida if I just moved there. I'm like, it's got to be Flipper, right?
Yes.
Is that how it is? But they were shooting a bunch of stuff down there at that time.
Well, I started working in Miami. I started taking acting, doing some modeling, taking acting class in New York just because I was bored in the summers.
Right.
And then when I got back to Florida one year, I think I was like 15 maybe or so. And I ended up registering with an agency there. And I started going on auditions. And I think it was because it was such a small market that I was, you know, able to get some good credits under my belt. You know, before I went to New York,
I did
a couple of episodes of Miami Vice, which were fun. I actually have them all now on video.
Which must have been, I mean, that was the coolest show on earth at the time it was airing.
Well, I think I did one of the first episodes because no one even knew who Don Johnson was. And he was absolutely beautiful. I mean, I've never seen eyes like that in my life.
Right.
And I thought, God, good looking guy. But I didn't know what the show was. And then it got to be a hit. And then I did another episode, which was a lot of fun. I did, you know, I got cast in movies that came through town. The Heavenly Kid with Jane Kasmerick and Richard Mulligan was fun. And that was really my first experience, you know, and I loved it.
Unusual for most people because it came to you. It's outside of Hollywood or New York. Like your film, you're having that experience of making these mainstream major things, but they're where you live, which is sort
of
different.
That probably really gave me an advantage because of my mindset. You know, I think at least for me, you know, surroundings can really influence me.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, especially at that age, you know, if we really don't have a good sense of ourselves, it's easy to get thrown off.
Right.
I still remember the first time I was in New York for the summer, you know, as an adult, when I went back after living in Florida for so long, and I was so horrified to even go down the subway.
Right.
And I thought, why am I like this? I was here for a few years ago, but I was like a kid, you know, and I went back 4 or 5 years later. It was very, very scary. And so when I remember when I would start going on auditions in Florida, I was so confident, you know, youth, right? Your ignorance and confidence, right? It'll get you everywhere. So, you know, I was going to performing arts high school at the time. And then I went to, started the first year of a community college down there. I had gotten a theater scholarship to University of Florida and I turned it down because I was scared that I would graduate college and be a waitress.
Right.
Like I wasn't, you know, much of a student.
Exactly the same.
Really? Yeah. And I thought, what am I doing? College, you know, I'm not, you know,
I'll end up in debt and not any really better off.
Right.
Yeah.
So I didn't think that that was maybe the smartest idea for me. And I had started auditioning already. And I thought, let me just continue, you know, down this path. And so between going to performing arts high school and then, you know, Broward Community College where I went to, they really instilled an ethic of, you know, hard work and the theater is everything. And, you know, Miss M was my teacher who I absolutely love and adore. She's out there. Hi, Miss M. She lives in North Carolina now. She was so great. And Joseph Capello was my other teacher down there. He was amazing. I still talk to them now on Facebook. But, you know, they would almost make fun of TV in a way. So I just thought, I'm a theater actor, you know. And so when I went in to meet on these movies, they're like, well, you don't seem nervous. No, why would I be?
Yeah.
You know, like, so ridiculously,
it was
just ignorant of me.
But I mean, that's helpful.
It was helpful really for my mindset. You know, it was like playing the home game, you know, I was on my turf. So that's the point that you bring up.
Yes.
Thank you for that's so interesting that you brought that up because I never really thought of it that way, but it really did give me an advantage to sort of be on my home you know, my home turf. And then, you know, it hits you. Oh, you know, you're on the set. Dude, I don't really know what I'm doing. Oh, my gosh. You know,
I'm a fraud. They're going to know.
So scary. And you know, the actors were so wonderful and helpful, you know.
Which I found, like, people assume there's a ton of horror stories. And there are. But for the most part, especially doing the show in 6 years, so many people are just really nice and humble and helpful, and they just want to like help the other actors. And
yeah, I have had horror stories in bed, which I tend not to focus on. But for the most part, definitely positive. And I never had, you know, any real experience with any kind of, you know, sexual harassment or anything like that.
You get diva-ish people probably, or like miserable people, but they want to. They're usually more inclined to hear more stories of people taking someone under their wing, rather than being like, get out of here, kids. They're like, oh, you're new. Let me tell you how it works.
I didn't really feel like I had a mentor, but I did feel, you know, I just remember on that movie, they were helpful.
Yeah.
100%.
Well, you had picked, we'll get to the days in a moment, but you had picked Soap.
Yes.
And Richard Mulligan is
Soap
amazing.
Was so fantastic. Yeah. I just had chills going up my legs.
But were you, clearly you were watching it when it aired. And
yes.
And then all of a sudden you're in a movie with Richard Mulligan.
You know.
I don't think you had scenes with him, did you?
I didn't have scenes with him, but I remember talking to his wife and I remember talking to him on the set. I don't know why, but I wasn't very starstruck ever. I just wasn't that starstruck.
Would you get, like, this happens to me where
I probably didn't even connect it. I probably just didn't even remember. You know, I didn't, this is what I think it was. When I watched a show, for the most, I'd say 80% of the time, I was just in the world of the show.
Right.
I think the only person that I kind of fell a little in love with was, like, you know, Fonzie.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I loved Henry Winkler.
I just loved him, you know, but then it kind of didn't. I had, you know, girlfriends that, you know, my girlfriend Ellen, who I love, Ellen Gannis, who I work with in a nutrition company. But she, I just remember her coming over to my house and, you know, her just being so starstruck. Like, we both did extra work on some movie down in Florida. And she was like, held the lead's hand. She's holding the cup. She's like, but he drank out of this. I was like, you are crazy, girl.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I never felt that way, so
that's a skill,
I don't know why. I just was more into the story.
Right.
The story's what mattered to me.
Right.
More than anything.
You didn't fixate on the, it's not even the fame, it's like the,
it wasn't the person who was playing the part. It was like they were that person and this is that world. You know, even when I went up, I think the first time for Ryan's Hope, I was a huge General Hospital fan during that whole Luke and Laura time.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember being bored, you know, one summer, I think we were visiting my grandparents in New York, and I remembered, I think I was watching Ryan's Hope, and I knew the world, and watching it didn't make me intimidated of it.
Right.
Because when I got onto that set, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm in the city. Like, it was almost like being at a pop-up store, you know, how they have like the pop-up stores now, Saved by the Bell. Or, it's like, I'm in it, you know, and I know the history of this town. So maybe
easy.
I was a little insane, but it made it easy. It's about the story.
It sounds like you could let yourself go a little more than most people are able to while still being sort of tethered to reality. You know, you weren't losing yourself that way. But it's funny where there are, I never take for granted, like, getting to talk to people who were on things that I just, you know, Boston's a billion miles away from any of this stuff, aside from Spencer Fryer. And getting to talk to people and having all these great experiences, that for most people, one of those things would be their one story for their whole life. Like, your friend would be like, I was an extra in this movie and I saw the, you know, that's like their, their party story, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so it's sometimes like I'll sort of repress it. And then later, like when I'm editing, sometimes I'll be like, oh my God, I'm talking to, you know, whoever it is. Cause it'll hit you later. But
if you're in the moment and you're really listening to somebody, it's like public speaking,
right?
You know, when I first started doing it, it was so scary. And then I realized, you know, they do not care.
Nope.
They do not care.
Yep.
They only care about what they're going to get out of it.
Yep.
You know, so as soon as we take the, you know, the focus off of ourselves, I guess it's like an acting as well, right? You know,
don't internalize. Like,
well, if you're self-conscious, you can't be an actor, you know.
Or a good actor.
You can't.
That's what I tell people for stand-up, and sometimes kids will get mad at me about it because it sounds like I'm dismissing what they're doing. But I'm like, look, unless what you're set is really bad, like the worst set anyone's ever seen, or amazingly good, most of these people probably won't remember anything that you did.
Right.
And, but yeah. that's me. That's great. You, yes. That totally frees yeah. you up to be. And so it's kind of that same thing. Like
on the other hand, though, it could get me in trouble, you know, also, and I think that later on I thought, okay, I need to get a little more educated because this is, it's not cool because I'm missing out, I think, too. And I'm, I think it just wasn't smart. I mean, eventually you know, it's smarter to know who you're with so you right. can learn from them and, right. you know.
Right. You're like, this person, I should try to get some advice. Yes. They know some things.
Yeah. Or yeah. like the first time I did when I was on Leno, and now I'm forgetting his name again, like the most famous country singer ever.
Oh, Willie Nelson?
No, not him. Oh, he's amazing.
Johnny Cash.
You know, at the time, not that far back.
More Clint Black?
More current.
Garth Brooks.
Yes. I think it was Garth Brooks. I was so nervous. I never watched late night. I right. was like sleeping. And I was so nervous, literally shaking. And I went out, and if you watch the tape, Garth Brooks puts his hand out to shake my hand, and I just completely turned yeah. around.
You probably didn't even notice it.
I didn't even see. There wasn't even a person there. Like, yeah. they didn't review that. Like, there's going to be somebody else on the couch. Like, unless they said it to me and hammered it into my head, it wasn't going to penetrate because I yeah. was so nervous.
Was it because you were going out as you?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
For me, I fell in love with acting because it was the first time, I'll never forget it. I was at Herbert Berghoff Studios in New York City in the summer. And the only reason I was there is because I started modeling. And I did say to my mother, like, when am I going to start talking? And she's like, that's acting. That's yeah. not modeling. I was yeah. like, maybe I think I want to do that. And then I tried to go out on a commercial and I was so petrified when I looked at the lines.
Right.
And my singing teacher at the time said, you know, take her to study. And so I went to HB Studios in New York, which is an incredible experience. And I remember the first time that we had some sort of exercise and I was, you know, on their little stage and I believed my circumstances. I was so comfortable. I was more comfortable in my acting scenes than I was in my life.
Right. Right. Because you know where it's going.
You know where it's going,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
I just felt more comfortable. You know, I just felt yeah. at ease in that situation.
That makes sense.
So,
and
yeah.
It's weird that people assume if you can do that, you can also do a talk show appearance and it's just as easy, but they're totally different
completely
things.
Completely different things.
And it's the same with stand-up where I always say, oh, that person's funny. And then I realize they're not. Like, off stage, they can't just talk. Like, they've memorized their thing. They have a thing.
They can only do their thing.
Yeah, they're not just
5 minutes or they're 20 minutes.
To, like, how I'm on stage, that's the same, you know?
Yes.
But there are people who are not, and it's sort of like it's almost like a monologue. It's like a suit of armor they've put on, and they can't be funny off the cuff. They panic. And
right.
that was very shocking to me, because, you mm-hmm. know, it's always hard to get out of your own head and assume everyone thinks like you do when you're younger.
Yes,
you're
yeah.
like, oh, no, they don't. This is true.
Yeah,
so that's not unusual. So were you watching any of the stuff that you were in? Obviously, Miami Vice sounds like it hadn't started airing.
No, it hadn't started airing. I guess I had watched Ryan's Hope, you know, years before. What else did I do at that time? I mean, movies,
yeah.
you know, so.
Was it weird to see yourself in a movie, which is a whole different, I mean, that's the larger than life thing. Was it kind of like, wow, once you see it?
It was a lot of fun. I remember watching one scene in The Heavenly Kid where I was just god awful, and I just thought, oh my god, that's not good. I better like figure out what the heck I'm doing, you
right.
know. That's really the only thing I remember thinking.
Right.
No, I just kind of went back to what I was doing. I was really right. just more in the moment at that time, which was great. I think that, you know, later on I started getting a little bit more in my head when I started getting things, and you know, I started getting self-conscious, and mm-hmm. then it became challenging for me.
Was that when you, after you had already moved out to Los Angeles?
After I moved here, after I was on a series, I started seeing kind of like what was at stake.
And, right. The pressure.
And it, yeah, the pressure kind of got to me for a little bit in there, and I went off and did other things. And,
yeah.
you know, I worked for a while after that, but it was, wasn't as much fun. And then I ended up taking a decade off, which was a really wonderful experience. I produced and, which was just incredible learning experience.
You produced a ton of stuff for TV Land, like, which was kind of like perfect for this show.
Yeah, I did. I was lucky enough to produce shows with iconic celebrities like Farrah Fawcett.
Yeah.
We did Chasing Farrah.
And Shatner.
For TV Land. Yeah. Yes. William Shatner in concert, which was wonderful. 1 hour special for them. And, Day in the Life of Dick Van Patten, my father-in-law, which was the pilot episode, actually, for that show. I also did Shirley Jones and her husband, Marty. It was a lot of fun. We had a lot of things in development. I helped form Windmill Entertainment, which was, it was an incredible learning experience.
And was
did you
gravitate towards that because they were subject matters that you watched growing up, or were you like...
No, you know, Craig Navius, who directed me in a show called Black Scorpion, gave me a call and said, you know, I know that you're on Baywatch, and do you think that you would like to work with us to help get the rights to the Baywatch cast?
Ah, okay.
And I thought, okay, you know, I can do that. His idea sounded great to me. And so I started out doing that, and then I just kind of went forward with it. I really love learning, and I liked a lot of his ideas. He worked well with actors. And for me, the biggest thing was... I think that I was just comfortable in both worlds. I was comfortable calling agents. I've spoken with agents my whole life. I was comfortable talking to actors, and I think I was a good liaison between, you know, a lot of times there's a separation. There shouldn't be, but a lot of times there can be a separation between the suits, you know, and the actors, right? The creatives and the producers. And so it was nice to be a bridge between those and
like
to bring that together. So I really like that. And then after that, I started developing things, and you know, it was fun.
Is it Joan Severance that was in Black Scorpion?
Joan Severance was in the film.
Yes.
And then they went ahead and did a series of it.
Okay.
Yes.
I didn't know. That was cool. Was Roger Corman?
Yes, Roger Corman.
Sort of a superhero.
Yeah, and everyone's got some Roger Corman projects under their belt for sure.
It's for him, it was cheap, and he knew that he had a hungry, talented people. But yeah, it was the film school. I mean, you know, the list of people that went through unofficial Corman film school is...
Yeah, they really had it down in terms of how they shot. They had a factory going there, for sure.
I had Penelope Spheris on, and she directed Wayne's World, but she had done The Decline of Western Civilization, and she directed a movie for Roger Corman.
Mm-hmm.
And funny story, she said, you know, she asked him, you know, what's a tip on directing? And he's like, get a comfy chair, and left. And first she was like, what a jerk, like that's... But then she's like, that's actually the best directing advice I've ever gotten. And because it's just so practical, you know, and that's, I think, how that stuff ended up being.
That's something I never have ever had aspirations to do. When I see what directors do, you know, anyone that's good really takes on every aspect of production, you know.
That sounds like a nightmare.
I had the pleasure of working with Kenny Ortega, who directed me in Hall High, and he went on to do High School Musical. He just got a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. He's done so many incredible projects. You can look him up, but or anyone out there if you're not familiar with him. But and then my husband's uncle, Tim Van Patten, has had so much success. And I just remember recently talking to him and saying, I don't know how the heck, you know, that they put in so... they get there before everyone, they leave, and they have to have a vision for the entire, you know, production. It's really incredible.
Yeah, it's a level of organization and like being able to zoom out, you know, two steps back to the whole picture. And then, so Hull High is sort of way ahead of its time. And it was a show that was sort of 20 years too early in a lot of ways, right? But was that the first big series that you got as a... She was the lead, basically, in that show, right?
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I think that it was. I think I had done some pilots before then. But yes, that was my first series regular on a show that was... picked up, you know, besides being on the soap.
Right. Which is a whole different world, the soap.
It really is, and it's really great training.
Yeah.
It's fantastic job.
I say it's like acting boot camp.
It really is incredible. But, you know, Hull High was a dream job, I think really because Kenny Ortega. And you know, the time slot was problematic. They put us Sundays at 7. We were opposite 60 Minutes.
Right.
And when they first aired us on a Wednesday night, we did come in 63, which is pretty decent.
Oh, yeah.
And then, you know, Sunday we went down to like 83. And I think only like Ferris Bueller's Day Off and 90210 were like around the same. But they got to stick around because they were given a chance because they were on Fox,
right,
which was the new network at the time. There was no programming, right? And Hull High was quite expensive to make.
I imagine, yeah. It's a full-blown musical.
Yeah, I remember one day, you know, the producers came down and literally pulled the plug as we were shooting.
Wow. And that's when you knew the show was done?
No, they were like, you're done for tonight.
Oh, you've
like,
spent too much.
You've spent too much money today. You're here too late. It's over. Like, you know, they literally pulled the plug.
But I think about Hull High a lot and about Cop Rock, which is the same season, I think, because the musical is a staple of entertainment.
Yeah. I have to say, okay, Cop Rock was, they did come on at the same time, and yes, they can be a little corny because we're just breaking into music. But however, Hull High had some, at least some, first of all, we're set in high school, right?
Yeah.
And so that's number one. Number two is that some of our sequences came out of fantasy.
Right.
In Cop Rock, it was a little weird. I just felt like it was a little more, even more cornier because, you know, they're in
they're
the
cops.
Middle. They're cops. You know, they're singing jurors, you know, so.
That was a little stranger.
I think that, yes, it definitely
but,
was.
But when I look at like a show like Riverdale, which I enjoy.
I have never seen it because I was friends with Luke Perry. He was my, he was working on Loving when we were on Ryan's Hope. And he was also my roommate for a short time because he and my best friend, Yasmin Bleeth, were together.
Baywatch.
And so anyway, those were great years for us. And so I cannot watch Riverdale because I see Luke and I don't know, for some reason,
it's
weird
tough
for me.
Yeah. And he's very good on it. But they do a musical episode every year. And
they do?
They do.
Oh, I have to watch. Maybe that's
those
fun
are cool
to watch.
And the way they do it is very Hull High in that every high school does a musical every year in real life. And so they
oh, okay. So it's a high school.
It's
okay.
A high school and they're doing a musical.
So Riverdale is in it. I know nothing
it's
about
Archie.
The show. Got
it's
it.
Archie
okay.
Comics. So they're doing a high, you know, the musical for the high school, but they do it as a musical episode. So they do a real musical. So like one year they did
How creative.
Heather's
I love
the musical
that idea.
Or whatever. But it's filtered into the plot of the show and it's not on stage. They do all the songs, but
fantastic.
It's very interesting. It reminds me very much of Hull High.
Okay, great. Thank you for letting me know.
Oh, you're welcome.
That.
Yeah. And it's interesting because again, Hull High was 1990 and we're talking, you know, some years later, they're really using that same exact sort of format which was so sort of innovative at that time.
Reboot of Hull High.
Yes, it's time is now. So let's dive into some of your picks.
Yes. Like.
What'd you get on the first night there?
Okay, so the first night is Saturday. Saturday? Okay. Oh. 8 o'clock. You have to tell me that you picked Welcome Back, Kotter.
It was, you had to do Welcome Back, Kotter, I think. It was the show everyone watched. I cannot watch it.
Really?
It's just...
Oh, now you can't watch
it. Yeah, like I try to revisit all these shows.
Okay.
And Welcome Back, Kotter is one that I just can't...
You know, you're right. I recently tried to watch it and I couldn't, but I loved it at the time.
Yeah, but I think that's who it was for. I think it was for like 10-year-old girls.
My mother loved it as well.
Oh, really?
Oh, she loved it. But I fell in love with John Travolta, of course, during that time. And then later, I ended up... I think Gabe Kaplan worked with us on one of our shows.
Yeah.
And again, I don't like meeting the people, you know? You know,
it
Gabe Kaplan.
It, for you,
it really does. He's a great guy, you know, but he's like an avid gambler. I want to see him in the classroom.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
I want Mr. Kotter.
Yes, I want Mr. Kotter. Anyway, it's Welcome Back, Kotter. Okay, what did you say?
Which is, I mean, you had to. Like, although I.
What else was
I
there?
I have to go Rhoda.
Rhoda. I didn't even see Rhoda.
Yeah,
I just saw Welcome Back, Kotter.
Welcome Back, Kotter's first thing, so then you're like, done.
Yes.
But Rhoda's on, and I love that show. Valerie
Rhoda
Hopper
was great.
So great.
You know what? You're right, and that's something you can watch again today.
Yes, that is so rewatchable. And that's fascinating to me to see what holds up and what doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
Surprisingly, more holds up than doesn't, I've discovered, which was sort of shocking. But
we're seeing it now, right? With all of the, I mean, I just watched almost every episode of Cheers.
Yeah, it's great. It's great. It's Cheers is so timeless. It doesn't, you almost can't tell when it's set. Because it's just like, you know, and I always wondered what Cheers, because growing up in Boston, it was huge. And it was weird to me that that was true the whole, I didn't know that it was popular the whole country. Because you just assume it's like this local sports team or something.
Yes, it was hugely popular. Yeah. I never watched it at the time, which is why I was so grateful to be able to go back now and see it.
And it holds up. I mean, that pilot is one that in screenwriting classes, they're like, this is a perfect pilot.
Yeah.
But the pedigree of the people they had making it was, you know, MTM. And they knew what they were doing.
James Burrows, right?
James Burrows, yeah.
I was lucky enough to work with him on an episode of Friends that I did.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And he just would come in and he would just give you incredible physical comedy in like 30 seconds flat and be out. And come back in, incredible physical comedy and be out.
Yep.
It's like, oh, is that genius?
That's what he's doing. Yeah. It's like, it's James Earl Brooks. Yeah, but I love Rhoda. It was only two seasons, I think, or three seasons. And it's one of those dialogue shows, which is kind of why it holds up. It's like,
I'm going to go back and watch it.
Yeah, I recommend watching it. What else do you have on there?
8:30, I've got Good Times.
I do like Good Times. That also, I think, holds up.
Mm-hmm.
And to the point of, you know, as a latchkey kid, you're experiencing things that you wouldn't otherwise. Like, I didn't know any black people in Boston.
Right, yeah.
And seeing...
Really? In your area?
None. Yeah. Boston still sort of is. It was very segregated sort of city.
Yeah.
Not intentionally. It just kind of...
Now as well? Up.
Not as much now, but yeah, then it's still very like provincial neighborhoody.
Right.
There's like, here's the Italian neighborhood and here's, you know, it's gotten sort of gentrified now where it's become more socioeconomic in it. It's like, here's the really expensive neighborhood.
Right.
And then where people can afford to. So it's gotten rid of some of it. But yeah, it's still pretty like weirdly like, this is my street and I don't go anywhere else.
I guess growing up in this city is more ethnically diverse and then also in South Florida as well. But, you know, you look back at Good Times now and, you know, it's not reality, right?
Right.
But what great characters.
Oh, yeah. And just the idea of it was people, you know, they're in Cabrini Green, they're in a project, they're like kind of struggling financially. Like that part I identified. Right.
The projects I have been in did not look that good.
Right. Yes.
But,
yes. And Cabrini Green didn't look that good either. Yeah.
Yeah.
The movie Candyman, the horror movie, that's Cabrini Green.
Oh, okay.
And I always point out to people, I'm like, that's where Good Times is.
Yeah,
that's more like what it was. But all that Norman Lear stuff was so eye-opening.
I'm so scared of horror movies that
really?
I don't even know. Like, I've never even watched Candyman.
That's a scary movie.
Yeah.
But it's smart in that it manages to do the thing that horror movies do when they do best. And it's a beautiful allegory for like racial sins in America.
Interesting.
Virginia Madsen's really good in it.
Oh,
it's
just her.
It's very well done, but it is terrifying.
Well, they've done their job then.
Yes, they have. But I always love Good Times. And then what'd you do?
Have Love Boat and then Fantasy Island.
Which I think was just like the law that you had to watch those things.
Did you? Was it too?
I did. To me it was always like good value for money because you're getting like three shows in an hour basically. Because of all the different stories.
Yes, the different stories. Yeah. I loved it.
It was great. I loved the surprise of it.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, I don't know what I'm going to get this week.
Yeah.
Which, you know, you might have Phil Silvers on. Is Charo going to be like, just, you'd have old Hollywood, new Hollywood.
Seems like everyone did that show. And I ended up doing the Love Boat. They did like a Love Boat 2 or something.
Oh, The Next Wave?
The Next Wave.
Robert Yerk?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
I did an episode of that, which was a lot of fun.
Did they take you out on a cruise?
No.
Because on the original, they did
take you out on a cruise.
You went on an actual cruise.
I do remember that.
Which?
I know some people that did it, and I think that they did say that.
Everyone I've talked to has done it. It's like, yeah, it was great. You went out for 2 weeks on a cruise.
Great budget.
They paid
there.
You. Yeah. Oh, well, that show was enormous.
Mm-hmm.
Like it was on till 1985.
Yeah. And Dick Van Patten, my father-in-law, did an episode. And Bernie Capel, we knew very, very well for years. Again, when I see Bernie, I don't associate him with...
Right.
Being, he was the doctor, right?
Oh, yeah, he's Doc. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's,
you know,
that's an enviable skill to be able to separate those, because there's definitely people that, for the most, you know, I play it cool, but for some people, like, you meet them and you're like, you don't realize how much you watch them when you're growing up, or like how weird it is to be seeing them, and they're just a person. Bernie Capel would be strange.
10 years that show ran.
Yeah. And it was huge.
Yeah, that was a good payday. You know, interesting bit of trivia. My father-in-law was offered both the Love Boat. So Dick Van Patten was offered the Love Boat and Eight is Enough.
Really?
And he ended up choosing Eight is Enough.
In this Captain Steubing role on Love Boat?
I think so.
Gavin McLeod. Yeah.
And or maybe it was the doctor. I don't remember.
Yeah.
My husband Nels would know if you have him on. Yeah, they always joke, you know, Dickie was amazing and that, but you know, Love Boat ran for a longer time. The lot bigger payday at the end of the day, you know.
But I associate him so much with Eight is Enough.
Yes.
Like it's so perfectly.
And it's here on this week.
I'm just curious who is on Love Boat this night. Pat Harrington, Bernie Capella is in there. Who are the guest stars? Jeanette Nolan, John McIntyre, Bert Convy, who seem to guest star in everything. And that's it for that one. And then let's see.
Fantasy Island.
Who do we have? We have Stuart Whitman, Phil Silvers. Two old-time vaudevillians, Phil Silvers and Phil Harris, won another shot at showbiz. And a woman played by Carol Lindley, who has just come out of a coma, wants to be reunited with her lover, a man no one has ever met. So you would know it could be anything.
They could still remake that show today. Everyone wants to be in a fantasy. Who doesn't?
They tried to do Fantasy Island in 97 with, why am I forgetting his name, from Clockwork Orange, Malcolm McDowell, in the O'Rourke role.
That's surprising.
And in the Tattoo role, this was the weirdest one, was Medjanomic. They went totally different, Hervé Valachez.
But it just didn't go, they didn't do it well.
No, I feel like it would work now, but in the 90s, it was too sincere, and I think people were still in the big irony realm, because they would have wanted something more
campy. Yeah, I think you're right. It could work now.
But I think you could do it now.
Yeah.
Especially, even if you did a dark take on Fantasy Island.
Yeah,
like
that.
How did they not do that?
Yeah.
Sunday night, what'd you do? This was a tough night.
Well, it starts out well. All in the Family.
Yeah. Check. Again, that Norman Lear.
Absolutely loved so much.
That show was so important to just getting people to talk about stuff. And I think about it a lot now for a variety of reasons. But people who didn't even watch it would still talk about the stuff that happened on the show and have like a dialogue about it. And that's kind of amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's a sitcom.
Well, they dealt with, it's a serious sitcom. I mean, they dealt with so many important issues just by having, you know, Archie Bunker be such a buffoon.
Yeah.
It was so great that the bigot on the show was just such a buffoon.
Yeah. Although there are people who watched it wrong. Like my dad would be like, I love that guy. He's telling it like it is.
No,
supposed to laugh at him.
Well, he was a buffoon on it, you know. And then Jean Stapleton was just so brilliant. I mean, that's like my dream part.
Oh, to be
one day, yes.
I think it was an Archie Bunker's Place episode after they had kind of transitioned into that from, but there is a moment, it's when Edith dies and Archie's being Archie and he's really not affected by it. And then after everyone leaves, he sits down in his chair and he finds her slipper under the chair. And Carol Connor's such a great actor.
Yes.
He just breaks down. And it's so sad, but like one of the best scenes in television. It's so good.
I never watched, because you did feel bad for him. He was so brilliant in that way. I never watched Archie Bunker's Place. Did he end up changing? Did his character end up being enlightened at all?
Yeah, because he like adopts a kid. And so they kind of soften him up that way. They also did do a pretty smart thing where without Edith to be sort of his Jiminy Cricket, sort of, he starts taking that on himself a little more. And I think if it went on longer, they might have had more of an arc, but he definitely becomes less truly sort of hateful. Mm-hmm. By that time, which people do when they get older sometimes.
It's just great how they would always put him in the situations with everyone he didn't want to be. It was like, geez, now
like
I got to deal with
Junior
this.
He
wasn't a hateful man. I mean, he still was there.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. He wasn't actively trying to destroy people.
Yeah.
He just
didn't like, exactly.
He kind of didn't like anyone.
Yeah.
Which is kind of the thing. It was like, well, yeah, you're racist and a bigot, but who do you like? Like, you seem like nobody. That show is so very 70s, but it's interesting to watch.
Important show. Yeah. And I think as well, that show was in the bottom of the ratings and they gave it longer. You know, they gave it a chance.
Because I think then you could, because part of it was, I've learned, the ratings took longer to get and to see trends.
Interesting.
So in the mid-90s is when they started being able to be like, we know every 15 minutes.
Right.
And we also know it's 13-year-old girls, or like very specific.
Right.
So that's when they stopped sort of letting shows breathe a little bit, because they were like, nope, it's not working. Go.
And what a shame that would have been, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Cheers, too. Cheers was in the bottom 20.
Interesting.
And they let it go. I mean, that was also Brennan Tartikoff at NBC was who were
last.
Him.
Yeah.
Did you ever meet him?
I did, because he was the head of NBC when I was on Hull High.
Oh,
and,
yes.
And he was just such a champion of mine. And I'm so grateful that I got to meet him.
Single-handedly saved that network.
Yeah, he's amazing.
I mean, Miami Vice, that was the famous MTV cop story with him. And he was just, the fact that they had nothing to lose allowed them to throw so much weird stuff at the wall, and you got Sam, I swear. I mean, you also got Misfits of Science and Manimal and all the stuff that really go on forever, but which people forget, but you gotta, you know, it's trial and error.
I really liked him.
He doesn't come up as much now as how important he was for television. And I think that that's kind of a shame because he was also a rare head of a network that would show up on shows sometimes as a guest star.
Oh, did he?
He was in like a night.
Oh, maybe he was an actor. I don't know that. I don't know about his history.
It was weird to know who the head of the network was.
Interesting.
Yeah, he'd show up on Night Court. There's an episode of Night Court where a guy who's in Nielsen family gets arrested, and he's like, you gotta let me get home. Like, I have to watch these things. He comes and bails the guy out.
Oh, funny.
He's like, we need him. It's like a, you know, a little.
Oh, that's great. Yeah,
like
yeah.
Buzzer joke at the end, but it's very funny.
So he would just come and do a couple.
He'd do like a cameo. Yeah, like,
cameo.
I think he was in a Punky Brewster.
Right, that makes sense.
Alf
cute.
Or something. Monday night, what'd you do?
I did Little House on the Prairie, because I, you know, you obviously didn't, but, you know, again, that fantasy, you know, to be in that.
Yeah.
Simple time.
That every woman I know who, if Little House aired when they were young, that was their favorite show.
Really?
It's,
I don't know if it was my favorite show, but I definitely,
it was like their campus.
Yeah.
Like, they gotta watch it every
week. I wasn't like that with it, but I really did. I just enjoyed it. You know, if it was on, I kept it on. I watched
because of the, I mean, it was rare to have a show with three young girls as the leads, but yeah, something about that era, for some reasons, like that Little Women, Anna Green Gables kind of world seems to be tapped into something.
Just, you know, I was always living in some, you know, sort of a city, and that whole country, you know, just seems simple and
so alien and
peaceful,
sort of,
you know.
That's a show I've never really watched. I think I've seen.
So what did you pick for that?
Instead, I went with White Shadow.
Oh, yes. Tim Van Patten.
Tim Van Patten was on this, yes. Which is a show I haven't seen a ton of, but I've kind of always enjoyed. It was a dramedy, basically.
Right. I never watched it. I never got past Little House, so I didn't even see it on the list.
Yeah.
But,
and it was about inner city basketball high school
basketball,
team.
Right.
Yeah. And I think it was only one season, but
he was so cute on it. Oh, was it only one season? Yeah.
So I think he did right after that. He did The Master with Lee Van Cleef, where he played a ninja. That was his post White Shadow. So yeah, I went White Shadow. And then what'd you do?
I did a movie, cause I couldn't pick. And then One Day at a Time.
So there's an interesting world premiere movie with Cindy Williams on that night.
Okay.
And one of the things that I always lament is the loss of the made-for-TV movies.
The movies of the week.
Which were huge and great.
Yes.
And big stars. And that's, to me, that seems like what every streaming service should be. Because you don't have to worry about syndication. There's never enough episodes. Like, you have all these movies. Just throw them on a streaming thing. Who wouldn't sign up for that? If we have 30 years of made-for-TV movies that no one's seen in forever.
You mean to take all the old movies of the week and put them up now?
Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. I'm sure that they will. I mean, they need content.
They need content, and they already have them, and there's big names, a lot of big-name directors.
Definitely, yeah.
And they never really came out on video. They're just there. And this one is it's set in the 50s, and it's Cindy Williams in Suddenly Love. It's a dramatic love story, but I've never even heard of
it. We kind of have Lifetime for all that kind of stuff, true. So maybe, I don't know. But there was a variety, I mean.
But they would really, I mean, they would spend money on this.
Yeah, they would.
Yeah, they were big deals. And it's just funny, it's just it was like a 20-year period, really, and then just gone. Would you say you did it 9:30?
So oh, one day at a time. Yeah, one day at a time.
So did you watch that at the time?
I did watch One Day at a Time, yeah.
Again, all female leads, which is pretty unusual. Valerie Bertinelli was like everyone's favorite thing in the world, apparently.
Yes.
At that time. And that show's funny. It's a single mother, too, which was pretty
It's a single mom, which I related to. You know, my parents are divorced, so
yeah.
You know, I think I related to that.
I think that's an important thing, too, to see your life reflected in these shows in a way that's not an ideal family.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, you see in the 70s, you know, everyone started getting divorced. I mean, yeah. I don't know if this is accurate, but it seemed to be that, you know, all of a sudden it went from that 50s, no one gets divorced, to all of a sudden everybody was getting divorced. So yeah. I think it, you
Which,
know.
Because now it was kind of okay. Like, there was probably a lot of people who should have been divorced.
Right, yes. There would have been less alcoholism among women,
absolutely.
Probably.
People could have been like themselves.
Yes.
But I think it was, it was more okay.
Yeah.
And by having things like this, it helped with that, I think. Because it wasn't like, I think it was Doris Day had a show where she was a single mom, but she was a widower. It was always to be.
Yes.
You know.
Or she didn't decide to leave.
Exactly. Or the Brady Bunch, I think they were both widowers. Yeah. You know, that was okay. But this one, it was, she's struggling, and it's hard to raise two girls on your own, and but it's still funny, and they're still a family, and that is great. Like, that's, to people who are in situations like that, it makes you feel more normal.
Yeah, because they lived in an apartment, you know, I could relate to that. Definitely, yeah. And on the other hand, I totally loved watching, like, you know, the Eight is Enoughs and the things where you know, the show Family.
Yeah.
Because
Me Too was so different from my family.
Right.
It was like, it's almost like anthropology. It's like, oh, that's how this
works.
Very interesting, yes.
That's how it's supposed to be.
Oh, I see. I'll take some notes.
At 10 o'clock, I wrote down Lou Grant, but I never watched that show.
I love that show.
Did you? It was a great show. He's great.
It's a drama. It's a straight drama, which is really weird because it spins off from a comedy.
Yes.
And it was an hour-long, single-camera, shot-on-film drama with Lou Grant, and he goes back to the newspaper business. And
it was serious, right?
Yeah.
Like, I remember, I mean, I know you said drama, but I mean, it had a serious tone to it.
It's a journalism. Like,
yes.
You know, we're writing the paper and we're investigating stuff. And that was weird to process, to see.
I think for me, I didn't watch it because I didn't accept him kind of in that world after seeing him in the other part. I think that's what it was. I was not accepting of that.
It's jarring. It's
yeah,
weird.
It was a bit jarring. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like when you see, because Mary Tyler Moore was shot on film, but like the first season of Newhart, the 80s show, they did on video and then they switched to film. And whenever I see that season, it feels so wrong.
So strange. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I know what it is, but you're like, something's off. And it was like that with Lou Grant. You're like, this isn't right. Like, it's bizarre, but it's a good show. Those are all on Amazon Prime right now, the two seasons.
Oh.
Yeah.
And that would be a good one to go back and
see. He's still working. I see him pop up and stuff.
Yeah.
Still
talented.
Frequently. He's in Cobra Kai, the Karate Kid show. Yeah, which I was shocked by. And he popped up in, the Doom Patrol.
How old is he now?
He's got to be 96.
Wow.
Good maybe.
For him.
He still does plays.
So talented.
Still does plays. Anything else on Monday?
I just have to go back. It just impresses me so much. These actors that are older, you know, I worked with Dick Van Dyke a few years ago and he would just come in like dancing in the morning.
Yeah.
Like what, how in the heck, you know,
you're 90 something. I can't do that.
It's unbelievable. And it's not easy to do, you know, to do a show.
Yeah.
It's just my hat's off. Anyway.
I think part of it's those guys came from a very specific time when they had this performance sort of work ethic.
Yes.
That was very
my father-in-law was like that.
Yeah.
100%.
That's what they did. You know, yeah. Their lifelong. Mm-hmm. I always see Dick Van Dyke at, there's a lot of like horror conventions out here. He's a big horror movie fan.
Oh, really?
And he'll go to just like get people's autographs. He's like just a fan. It's
oh,
really
I love
weird.
That.
It's like Dick Van Dyke's getting, you know, Barbara Steele's autograph. It's just bizarre.
Tuesday night is my favorite.
This is the Gary Marshall
night. This is the exciting night. Yes. I lived for this. Happy Days and Laverne and Shirley. And I love Three's Company and Taxi.
This is the height of all those shows, too.
These were the most popular, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Happy Days was... It's hard to convey to people now how popular that show was.
Because there's three networks.
There's three networks. And the number one show on TV now wouldn't even crack the top 100 in...
Yeah.
Especially then.
Don't you miss... I think that there's something, you know, that we're missing. It's so... I love having all this content to choose from. You know, yeah. It's so much fun binge watching and... Everything is so well done,
of course,
you know.
Yeah.
But I think I heard Seinfeld say, you know, oh, what is this? People saying, you know, are you watching my show? You know,
yeah.
And it was funny because you relate to it because we all do that, right? Are you watching my show? And he says, I'm not watching your show. You know, he doesn't want anyone to ask him. But I have to say that it felt so good to be connected, right?
Yes.
I mean, you could immediately connect to somebody.
Yeah.
You see them. There were three networks. Very few shows on prime time, right? There were just a handful of shows that were popular.
Absolutely.
Did you watch Happy Days? Yes, it was a great episode.
You had to.
You could talk about it and you guys share that.
Yeah.
So immediately, if you didn't know somebody, you know, it's almost like liking the same sports team,
exactly.
Right? There's immediate connection there. And I think that we, you know, it's wonderful and I wouldn't give it up at all, in the least, all of this content, but... There is something that I miss. It's a little bit lonely, you know.
It
you're
is.
Like, are you watching such and
yeah.
such? You're just hoping that they're going to say yes. You can connect, you know. And I do get so excited when someone says, "Yes, I'm watching Dead to Me." It's unbelievably good.
Yeah.
And did you see? You know,
which is also why I kind of miss the thing that binging takes from us is that you have a week in between to like think about it and talk to people who watched it and be like, "What do you think is going to happen?"
Yes, yeah,
and that. And then you build your anticipation to when it comes back on, and it really is a whole different thing.
It's a different experience,
and,
for sure.
I'm a big Twin Peaks fan,
uh-huh.
And when they did the return a couple years ago, they didn't put them all at once. It was weekly, and I forgot how great that kind of can be.
To the excitement,
yeah,
you're building
like,
up to the next
one.
Wow,
man, it's a cliffhanger. Like, oh,
yes.
What do you think's going to happen?
Yeah.
I don't know. And then I missed that, too.
Yeah, what would have happened with Dallas, right?
Yeah,
did they bring that back? No, Knott's Landing.
They did. They brought Dallas back with the full cast.
Yes.
It was until Larry Hagman passed away.
Right.
Then,
didn't they also bring back Knott's as well?
I think they may have.
I think they did.
Knott's.
Yeah. Grant Show.
Yeah. It's, again, sort of a lost genre that was huge at that nighttime soap opera.
You don't have that cliffhanger element, right?
Right. Because you just go, it's now the next one. And you know, you this may be oversimplifying, but I feel like you invest a little bit less because you know that you'll just get the satisfaction of whatever the thing was immediately.
I think also it has to be a notch above in terms of the writing. I just wonder, I'm just suspecting, you know, you can easily see the formula. You can see where it's, you know, if it's not, there's some shows, you know, the first season's great. You put it on again and, you're just going, oh, fast forward.
I get it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, this is disappointing.
Just keep redoing the same stuff. I mean, that's, especially now where TV switched to being serialized to sort of the norm.
Yes.
It's just, as someone who loves stories and storytelling, how hard is it to tell a story that you don't know when you get to end it? You have to keep the story going. And have an ending in mind, but you don't know when you'll do that.
I don't think there's that many shows that really do that well, right?
Yeah,
I mean, I didn't think, I mean, Cheers is great as I didn't think that they did that well.
They had
to
kind of go with the flow on some stuff.
I think the show that maybe, and I haven't watched everything, it's just my opinion, but The Shield, I think, really did that well.
Yeah.
You know, if you watch the pilot episode of The Shield, and you watch the end, if you watch it all the way through the end, it is solid. It wraps
very
up
consistent.
At the end. It really, they did such a good job. I haven't, I've only watched one episode of The Wire, and I know how brilliant it is, but I'm just scared that I'm going to go to a dark place.
I'm scared to watch Breaking Bad too.
They're incredible.
I just don't need that.
Not
kind
going
of bum
there.
Out.
Like, I do not need to go into that alternate universe.
Exactly. Like, I know there are bad things. I'm sure this is very well done, but I don't need to feel extra bad.
I'm with you. I think we're very similar.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like, and it's funny too, because you get that thing where those shows are made by absolutely brilliant showrunners who, you know, we were talking about directors earlier, like even more so, they have this thing mapped out that they can see that no one else can. And they're able to do something very difficult. When you start getting shows that they're not ripoffs, but they go, people get a misunderstanding of what made that show great. And they're like, okay, everything terrible happening. That must be the secret. Mm. So you start getting shows where it's just like, why is everything awful happening to everybody?
Right.
Like, I couldn't finish Dead to Me, which was great, but I was too...
Oh, really?
The whole time. Yeah.
Oh, I absolutely love it. Did
it's
it come
really
on
good.
For... I don't know if I've seen all of them. I have to go back and check.
I had to stop at the episode where they were, like, dismantling the car to get rid of it.
I have to go. It's been a while.
Yeah.
I have to go back and revisit it. But
I
it got too dark.
It was great, but it got too, like, I was like, oh,
did you watch The Affair?
Yes. Yeah.
Now, what... I feel so badly for that show.
Yeah.
What happened? I mean, when those people left, whatever their lovely, brilliant actors are that left... I love them, and now their names are slipping my mind. But that should have been it. I mean, it just should have been, okay, they're leaving in that season because they, as incredible as it was, it's like watching a different show.
Yeah.
It's not even in the same show. It's not good.
I think it's, again, that you have money people and creative people, and they don't mix. In those aspects where...
I wonder if they thought, we can convince them to stay.
Yeah.
So they didn't really plan for it. Because I heard that the actor said, no, we told them we were leaving.
Yeah. And they're like, this is a negotiating tactic.
I want... Because if I was a producer, well, wait, we can get them to stay.
Yeah.
You know, I'd be doing everything I could to get them to stay.
I've seen that, like, there's shows that thought they were ending and wrapped everything up. And then the network has gone, oh, you have another season. And they're like, we don't have any story to, like, and they have to, that happened to Cheers.
Really? Oh, yeah. It seems sort of clear on Cheers.
It happened to Night Court, where they were like, we thought we were done. And then they were like, oh, the show we were going to replace you fell through, so you guys do another season.
And you felt like it was never good.
Yeah, because the actors.
You could get the whole jump the shark thing. And
yeah. Or Chuck. I don't know if you're a show for Chuck, which was a good show and an interesting idea. But because it was on the bubble every season, they did a series finale. Four times.
Right.
So the next time it starts, you're like, well, didn't the world get saved? Like, who cares now? Like, the stakes were so high. And that's just like, it's like if someone's writing a book and the publisher is like, oh, don't finish it. Like, but they're telling the story and be like, we'll let you know when you can finish it.
I don't know how they do it. I mean, it's just such respect.
It's real. I can't imagine how hard that is.
I'm loving this little Space Invaders.
Space Invaders,
bringing me back to my childhood.
Nice little arcade.
Space Invaders, and then, you know, I was obsessed with Pac-Man as well.
That, again, I don't think people understand how huge Pac-Man was.
We used to go out, like, on a Saturday night, like, with my friends, but we would go to the 7-Eleven first to play Pac-Man for an hour, and then we would go out.
And probably spend 10 bucks and quarters, which is not small change. Q-Bert was my...
what was that?
Q-Bert was... it was this little orange guy, and you bounced on, like, this pyramid... And you had to change all the colors.
I don't know. I don't know, but I want to play it.
It's super fun.
And you're now telling me this guy's bouncing, and I'm already thinking of doing it.
Yeah. When I was in college, they had this little arcade, like, under a stairwell in the student center. And that's pretty much all I did. I was just, like, playing Q-Bert. Like, everyone's like, my college days, man. And I'm like, I played a lot of Q-Bert. Yeah. That was pretty exciting.
Good for you.
So that was cool.
It was fun. Kept you out of trouble.
Yeah. But it was funny, like, Pac-Man they tried to make into a cartoon.
Are you obsessive? Like, do you get addicted to
A little
stuff?
Bit.
I do too, yeah.
Which is why I also
I probably would have been in there with you.
Yeah.
In your college hall. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Because you're like, once I started, I have to finish
this. I want to be better at it.
Yes, yeah. I almost had it.
Yes.
Yeah, I was like, at one point, I think my initials were like all the top 20.
Yes!
I was like, I've done it.
I did it.
And it's like, oh, there's no one cares. This thing. But oh man, where are we? Tuesday. So Happy Days This Night is just before a scheduled performance at an orphan's benefit. An escape artist gulps down a glass of water that turns out to be pure vodka and quickly does a disappearing act. So then this is where Fonzie has to step in.
This sounds like a later episode. Is this toward the end?
This is toward the end.
Yes. Yeah.
I had Donnie Most on. And
yes.
Donnie, apparently he's the one who pointed out the jump the shark thing.
Yeah.
But he forgot.
When does he think that happened?
So we got the script for that episode where he literally jumps the shark. He was telling me he had...
Oh, where he literally jumped the shark. Yeah, yes, that's where it came from.
He was talking to Ron Howard recently. And he's like, Ronnie was like, Donnie, you're the one who...
Yeah, how did it start? He's the one that...
He pointed out how stupid it was.
He said, because I was... Tell me.
So he gets the script and he didn't remember this at all. Because Ron told me, I came into his trailer and I was like, what the hell is this? He's like, jumping. This is the stupidest thing I've ever seen in my life. And then everyone was like, yeah, this is really dumb. And then he like quit the show. Like he was like, this is stupid now. And then forgot about it. And then it became sort of infamous that
everyone started saying that's the end of a show.
The jump in the shark.
That's the jump the shark moment.
He had totally forgotten it was him. He was like, what the hell is this?
Yeah.
Which was amazing. I was like, of course you forgot because it's such a thing. I was like, jumping a shark.
Do people say that anymore?
I don't think it's as utilized, or if they do, they have no clue what it's
what
from.
It means,
because there was a website Jump the Shark
in the early
2000s that I think really when everyone was like, here's when this show got bad.
I think I remember seeing that episode of Happy Days.
It's a bad one.
Yeah,
well, the other thing about Happy Days, and this happened around the Laverne and Shirley too, is they stopped pretending it was the 50s after a while.
In Laverne and Shirley they did?
Yeah. They were just kind of, especially when they moved to Hollywood that last season.
Oh, see? I don't think I lasted.
Oh, it's
bad. It lost me.
Cindy Williams wasn't on the show anymore.
Oh, no. I didn't watch anymore. Nope.
It just wasn't in the episodes.
Yeah, no. I didn't watch anymore. I don't think I watched the ends.
It was, you're not missing much.
Yeah.
Although, you know what TV Land did? And it might have been actually when you were doing the show there. They did one of my favorite TV stunts ever, where New Year's Eve, they played all TV finales. And New Year's Day was all pilots.
Oh, I love that.
So it was like endings and beginnings.
Oh,
so they
fantastic.
Just marathoned, like 20 different shows, final episodes. It was really cool to watch them all at once.
Great idea.
Pilots. Where are we? Anything else on Tuesday?
Well, Taxi.
I love Taxi.
Three's Company, which I absolutely loved.
Two shows that couldn't be more different either.
Right?
Which, John Ritter is so funny.
So talented.
And that show could have, it's a little sleazy. But it could have come across as real sleazy, and he's so innocently likable.
He's not sleazy at all. So
that it completely counteracts any
right.
sort of like the Regal Beagle is like what you want to get away from on that show, and it's all him.
Yeah,
he's just great. Plus, do you prefer Furley or the Ropers? It's a tough call.
Who was first? Furley was...
Ropers were first.
Ropers were first.
And then they got their own show.
Right, but then it was canceled, wasn't it? And they really got a bum deal.
They did. And then
because then they couldn't have their spot back.
Yeah.
I remember not liking the fact that a new guy came on for a minute. Yeah. So.
And I love Don Knotts.
Yes.
But it was a very different...
Very different.
Yeah.
I think I liked the Ropers.
The Ropers were a cool dynamic because it was... Which I get why they would do a spinoff show, because the way they played off each other was...
And didn't he not want to have sex with his wife?
Yeah, that
I
was the
feel
whole
like,
thing. Yeah.
Like Married with Children, maybe.
Totally.
Sort of felt similar to them
the
in a way.
Like, come on. And it was, it was like that classic, like, oh, God. Yeah. Which even as a kid, I was like, what's wrong with him?
Right.
Married with Children, too.
Why
like, what's he complaining about?
Right.
He's doing pretty good. He married up.
10 o'clock, there's a movie?
At 10 o'clock.
I didn't have anything to watch at 10. What were the choices?
So the only thing on at 10 o'clock is an ABC News close-up about psychic healing.
Oh, yes. I wouldn't have watched that.
Yeah. Which, again, 1978, we were in the throes of all that. The UFO in search of... There was like a huge... We just started getting the ESP obsession and all those sorts of things.
Wasn't there like a 1-800 psychic thing for a while?
Yes. Miss Cleo.
Yes.
You remember her?
I think I do.
Yeah.
Isn't it crazy that there was like just one thing to watch?
Yeah.
And I remember talking to my mom about, oh, you don't know, there was nothing on, there was only one show.
Yeah.
You know, I thought they were living in the dark ages, but I guess we were as well.
And it sounds like you're being overly dramatic, and it's like, no, there's literally a news show about supernatural psychics and fortune tellers here.
Do you remember getting up in the morning and just seeing the peacock?
Yep.
With nothing on.
Or the sign-off. Anytime the sign-off would start, I would, A, feel panicked like I was going to get in trouble. Like, oh, no, I've watched TV to the end. Like, am I in trouble? And then just that sense of, like, there's nothing.
Yes, just alone.
Nothing. Yeah.
I just remember sitting there going, I can't wake my mother up.
Mm-hmm.
What am I supposed to do? I guess I'll just stare at the peacock.
Wait for the sign-on. Yeah. And Saturday mornings, I would get up. I didn't sleep much as a kid. Like, I definitely was up all night most of the time. But on Saturday mornings, I would get up at like 5 and like go, what? The cartoons are on.
Yes, yes.
But sometimes it'd be like 4:40 and you're like, I guess I'm just going to wait till TV starts.
I guess parents can't have, I wouldn't have a TV in my kids' room now because that's all they would do 24 hours a day, right?
I don't think that it matters, like, because they can do it on their phone. They can watch whatever they want.
You can't have it.
Whenever.
Yeah.
Which is kind of terrifying. I couldn't imagine. I always think about how crazy it is that in our pockets we have everything. We can watch any show we've talked about here, we could probably pull up and watch right now in your pocket. And that's the kind of thing where I'm like, we live in the future. Because if someone explained that to you as a kid, you'd be like, okay, future person.
Future person. Yeah. Yes, the Jetsons.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Those shows, by the way, just ruined me.
Yeah.
Bewitched, I Dream of Jeannie, and the Jetsons, yep. Because I still expect that I'm going to be able to snap my finger or, you know, move my nose, you know, and then breakfast is going to be there. The kitchen's going to be cleaned up. Yep. And we're almost at 2020. Like, shouldn't those things be happening
best
now?
Best thing we have is a Roomba.
Yeah, a Roomba.
Great, but it's not rosy.
We do have a phone, though.
Yeah, it's true. The phone could tell us how to do those things. We could hire someone to do those things. But yeah, it's those visions of the future are always really interesting to see what pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, TV Guide always had like a new technology column. And it's funny to read them and see how...
You would know this because you read it, actually, cover to cover. Columns.
Yeah, I read the articles. But I remember some of the 50s ones, they talk about like flat screen TVs and HD TV. This is like 1958. And it like they were 100% right about this.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really weird to see that stuff.
I remember my girlfriend and I talking about, you know, flat screen TV in the 80s. And, you know, our biggest problem in our life was... Why do we have to have an armoire to cover the TV?
Yep.
You know, we had to have the armoire because the TV...
You can't have people seeing the TV.
No, we have to put it in a cabinet.
Yes.
You know, that was just so awful to have a TV seen. And then she said to me one day, I heard that they've got TVs that mount on walls.
It's like a painting.
And we could actually, like, watch it in bed. And it could be on the... I was like, wow.
Yeah.
She said, they're like $8,000.
Yeah.
Well, there goes that idea, but...
But now there are, you know, $200 you can get
It's
there.
Ridiculous.
It's funny when I'm like, if I'm walking the dogs...
So great, isn't it?
Yeah, it's great.
I love it.
You look, you know, you see people in like a mid-century house and they have a wall-size TV on the wall. And you're like, it's so weird.
I wish I could be one of those people that's, you know, doesn't have the... But I must admit, we have a TV in almost every room of our house. Do you do?
Yeah, yeah.
We've got it in the dining room.
Yep.
It's just so multi-purpose now is how I justify it, you know?
Yeah.
You can... But plug it into the internet.
Yeah. Look at some family photos.
Yes, educational.
Yeah. But yeah, really, it's just like put something on. I don't know.
And it is more educational than ever, by the way, with all the incredible documentaries and biographies.
I find it so helpful because I'm not handy at all.
Yes, you can learn anything.
You can learn
YouTube.
Anything. I'm like, oh, my dishwasher's broken. And I'm like, pulling the model. And it's like, the exact thing, like, here's how to fix that thing in 5 minutes. I'm like, this is great.
Yeah.
And he's showing me, and it's easy. Yeah, that, whenever I start to take that for granted, I'm like, I could never have imagined this being available. But to what we're talking about when we first started, like, it is, there's something missing about that curated thing that, like, you're seeing stuff you wouldn't have maybe watched on your own or, like, chosen to watch, but it's just on. And you end up being exposed to a lot of stuff that you wouldn't have been otherwise that was great.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Or you had to watch a show because someone else wanted to watch it.
Mm.
And you end up loving it. Because there's a ton of things like that I would never have probably chosen to watch.
Right.
But I turned out to love.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have to do that now.
Right.
You can completely avoid it if you don't want to.
Especially with your 52 TVs in the house.
Exactly. Those are my other two theories. In my old man complaining, it's that young people don't know how to negotiate as much anymore because they don't have to make a case for their show.
Yes. Oh, that's funny.
You'd be like, no, we should watch this because.
Yeah.
And they're, I hate that they don't have to call, if they're calling a girl, there's not the possibility that their dad might answer. You have to get through a parent because that was
they're just calling the cell. I never thought about right that.
There's no those gatekeeper. Lucky people. They don't have to be oh, hello, sir.
It is better to have a gatekeeper sometimes.
It's these kids. Wednesday, what'd you do?
I didn't do anything at 8. What were my choices?
Wednesday, we have. So this is December 1978. So there's a lot of weird Christmas stuff on.
Yes, which I always loved the Christmas stuff.
So Rudolph is on that night.
Oh, I love Rudolph. Yep, when did he come on?
That's on at 8 on Wednesday.
Oh, I totally would have watched Rudolph.
Bing Crosby, The Christmas Years, Unforgettable Memories is on. And the Johnny Cash Christmas show is also on.
Well, I love Johnny now, but I wouldn't have picked him then. I didn't go for Bing, and I would have definitely had Rudolph. I loved Rudolph.
This is maybe the most famous Bing Crosby Christmas special.
Really, he was big. Yeah,
where he sings "Little Drummer Boy" with David Bowie.
Oh,
it was this special.
You remember it? You remember watching it?
No, but it's that song.
Oh yeah, you were like 2, right?
I wasn't
born. You weren't born. Oh, you were born in 80.
80, yeah.
Got it.
But the footage of them singing "The Little Drummer Boy" is forever. I mean, it's in. And it's such a weird, it's Bowie in 1978 with Bing Crosby.
What an unlikely matching that is.
It's very weird. And they wrote extra verses for that version. So the whole peace on earth, they wrote just so Bowie had something else to sing.
That's interesting trivia.
Yeah.
I have to say, Bing Crosby scared me. He seemed plastic to me. Mm-hmm. It was just like fake, weird plastic man that I did not resonate with.
He seemed like your friend's angry dad, where you just
he's like covering it all up, but he's really evil underneath it all. I didn't buy it. Yes.
Like, what are you hiding, man? Like, you get some demons.
I heard some stories. Yes.
Oh yeah. He always reminds me of the anti Robert Mitchum, and I love Robert Mitchum. They're semi-similar sort of characters, but I'm like, I want that guy to be my grandfather.
Yes.
He's so cool. And Bing, I was like, no, thank you.
Yeah.
Which I love. White Christmas is one of my favorite movies. Aww. And Danny Kaye is so much more likable than Bing Crosby. Where you're like,
I should go back and watch that.
And then Rosemary Clooney's great in it. A friend of mine is one of the archivists at Paramount. And a couple years ago, she was giving us a tour. And we stumbled on a friend of hers whose whole job there is to go through all the warehouses and find jewelry and fix it and figure out what movie it was from.
Oh.
It's not cataloged.
What a great game.
So she's got to go through stills and all this stuff. And she had just found all of Rosemary Clooney's jewelry from White Christmas.
Mm.
And my wife, who loves that movie, was like, what? She's like, yeah, look, this is the... And she's like, gonna put it on.
That's wonderful that they still have it, that they've preserved it.
For years, I think they didn't care. And I guess if you... Like in the 80s and 90s, if you rented a costume from those places, you could have rented the Cleopatra costume.
Huh.
And you wouldn't have known. It's like Elizabeth Taylor's Cleopatra costume. But they just had them and, I was like,
are they still doing that?
No. So now they know what they're... I think it's financial. They're like, we need to take an inventory of what we own.
Mm.
But now they're cataloging everything. But it's taking forever. And the other amazing thing was... If you have an office at Paramount, I don't know if the other studios do this, you can go into the warehouses and just put a sticky on what you want in your office.
Oh, how fabulous.
Because they're like, just in there, and we have people who can fix things. So you walk by the offices, and it's literally like, guy has a throne.
Yes.
This guy has the Maltese Falcons.
I love it.
I was like, that's the best
thing
I've
ever seen. That's fantastic.
And they might take it if they need it. But.
And it's great now with Turner Movie Classics, how you can watch all of that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a huge noir nerd, so that stuff. Have you ever been to TCM Fest?
I haven't, but I should go. I have a friend, Jeremy Arnold, that does a lot for them.
Yeah. It's fun.
I'm always inspired by him and So maybe I should go.
It's always at the Roosevelt.
And my mother-in-law, Pat Van Patten, is absolutely obsessed.
Oh, I bet.
24 hours a day she's watching. And she knows every single actor, the name of everybody.
Yeah.
You know, I absolutely love it.
Great. Yeah, Ileana Douglas does a ton of stuff for them. And, yeah, it's such a cool old Hollywood. Because they do up the Roosevelt. Like, it feels like you're...
They've done a great job redoing that hotel.
Yeah, it's amazing. You're like, this feels like I'm in 1955 or whatever. Yeah, so that's what you have all these specials on. But Rudolph is probably the way to go, which I still will watch every year.
Yes.
To your point too, we could watch that whenever we want, but there's something about it airing and we know other people are watching it at the same time that it's just a different thing. And I wonder if people younger than us who didn't grow up with that still get that.
I think the Christmas time, you know, you want to do Christmassy things during the time.
Yeah. Because I love those. Like, every year I watch the Macy's Parade. Every year since I was four, as long as I can remember.
Do you remember the Disney Sunday night movie?
Yes.
It was Sunday night,
Sunday
right?
Sunday night, yep.
Yeah, I just lived for that.
Yeah,
I remember
that's where they would do, like, the Shaggy D.A. and all the weird little pilots that never became things.
At 9 o'clock is Charlie's Angels.
Which, again, you was, like, required.
Which you didn't watch, right?
I love Charlie's
Angels. Oh, did you?
Yeah. Because it's just a fun, weird show.
Like,
it's pretty ladies fighting criminals. Like, who wouldn't like this? And this one is an embezzler, which seems to be always, uses Kelly's best friend to set up Kelly for murder. Who is in this one?
And Farrah's not on that.
Farrah's not on
because she only did one episode.
Yep, this is.
I mean, one season. People don't realize that.
Oh yeah, because she just grew out of that show. That poster that everyone had.
It's amazing how everyone had their hair like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, she was really, she was of her time and she transcended her time.
Yeah.
One of my mentors said that, and Larry Moss, I think, one of my acting coaches said that defines a classic.
Yeah.
You know? And she really was.
Just iconic.
Yes, like, she is.
And I don't know if you get people that do that. And I don't think it's possible to be that anymore. So when I think of like the last...
Because of all of the outlets.
Yeah. Just too many people. Yeah. Like there's very few famous people I can think of that, you know, I haven't been famous for like 30 years that everyone knows who they are. Mm-hmm. Like your grandmother knows and kids
know. People are winning Emmys and people don't even know who they are.
Yeah. There's shows that have been on 10 years and never even heard of it.
Yeah. People have no idea
NBC,
who they are.
I'm like, oh, okay.
Which it takes away from the star power, you know, of the actor, in which to say it takes away from how much money they're going to be getting
paid. Absolutely. So I'm sure the studios we like this.
Yeah.
Which again is like a show like Love Boat or Fantasy Island. We kind of don't have guest stars anymore. Like, who would even the guest stars be? Like, there were people, everyone knew who they were, but all they did was do guest star roles.
Yeah, and now we have a lot of famous people doing those parts, right?
Well, I think the stigma's gone of TV or movies.
Oh, completely,
Where it was like, once you graduated, you didn't go back.
I just remember my agent saying, you want to go up for a series, Nancy? You're doing films. You shouldn't do this. It's not going to be good for you.
Yeah.
You know, and I remember him trying to really plead with me, you know, not to do that.
Which is weird because you're like, but if this goes, this is like a steady gig.
Yeah.
Isn't that better? But it was just, they had no esteem.
And you still made so much more money in TV.
Yeah.
You know? And when you look at Don Johnson, how much...
Absolutely.
It's crazy.
But I mean, that did. Miami Vice had a clothing line.
Yes.
And then he put out Heartbeat, the album.
Did he?
Yeah, he put out an album called Heartbeat that was the world's first video album.
Was that Heartbeat? It's a love beat.
No.
Partridge Family song.
Yes, yes. different teen idol.
Yeah, loved him.
He put out a VHS album, so every song in the album had a video and it told a story. And he was like
how do you know this?
I've seen it. It's like, and Heartbeat charted, but he's like a Vietnam War photographer. It's really silly and very, very serious.
He's capitalizing.
Yeah, yeah.
Making the most of it.
Made good money. Where are we, Thursday?
I didn't always watch Charlie's Angels, but I did, you know, I watched it once in a while. And the big discussion was, you know, who do you like better? That was always the thing, you know. I know later the whole Gilligan's Island thing, you know, Ginger.
Right.
But... most people I remember saying, you know, Jacqueline or Farrah?
Yeah.
Are you a Jacqueline or a Farrah? You know.
Which is funny that the other one just like, oh, we're not talking about Kate Jackson.
Yes.
Yeah. It was like, nope. Yeah, it's funny how people, I wonder if there's shows like that. Friends seems like the last show that people actively sort of identified, I'm one of these.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe Seinfeld.
I'm a Rachel.
Yeah. I can't.
That was a great show to work on.
Did you do a couple episodes?
I did one episode. Yeah. It was a pretty well-known episode, it turned out to be. It was a good episode, Valentine's Day.
Okay.
Joey was trying to get... It's so weird how I go back and forth to the person's name or their character name. Matthew Perry's, whatever his name was. Chandler Bing.
Chandler, yeah.
To go on a double date because the girl he wanted to go out with, which was me, mm-hmm. would not go out with him unless her friend had a date.
Okay.
So I end up meeting him at the restaurant and I say, and if you remember, Chandler was with off and on.
With Monica?
Before he was with Monica, he was with the girl.
Oh, the annoying one?
Yes.
The laugh? Yes.
She's so funny.
Yeah.
Janice,
that's right, yeah.
So I say something about order me a white Zinfandel and a red for Janice. And I have this New York accent. And when I say that, his face just... And then she walks in and goes, oh, my God. And it's so funny. I mean, she's so funny. So that's gotten a lot of play, that episode. But Matthew Perry's so talented. Just a little inside information if anyone's looking for it out there. You know, they could do a million takes, right? They don't do a million. It's TV, right?
Yeah.
So they're doing two or three or takes or something. Most of the cast, take nothing away from, they're all incredible. They have like one line reading, you know, one or two.
Yeah.
Matthew Perry just changed it up every time and it didn't matter. He was just always funny. I remember one time the writers, you know, they were trying to work out something in a scene that wasn't working. They called him into the writer's circle. He was there working with them. Mm-hmm. So he's just very talented.
And
you know?
That was the fifth or sixth sitcom that he'd been
that
in
he had
by
done.
Then.
Yeah, so I'm just surprised this, that he hasn't.
They pushed
even
him
had
for
more.
Movies for a while.
Yeah, and I don't know like, if he translates.
I don't think he's a movie guy, which isn't an insult. Like he's so good at that.
Yeah.
Format, which is hard to be good at.
Right, and Joey, what's his name?
Matt LeBlanc.
Matt LeBlanc has had some funny shows.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, he extra. Is it extras?
What was that one?
Episodes.
Yes, episodes was great,
yeah,
right?
Which is fantastic.
I loved it.
It's funny the thing that I've noticed. You know, we were talking before about how like Brady Bunch or like Bewitched, and you know these shows that mm-hmm. were our shows as kids that we watched as kids, and the modern versions of those is Full House and Friends, and everyone I know that has kids or like you know tween age or they are obsessed with Friends.
Right,
they watch it four times
really?
A day because it's on TV. You know, they all watch it, which I never would have guessed. And people I know who were in one episode of that show or whatever, that's what they get recognized from.
I get recognized for Saved by the Bell.
That would make
sense
as well.
It's just the oddest thing.
Did you
know?
Go to the pop-up when it was
there? I did.
Yeah,
I went to the pop-up.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. But did people were like, you're here. This is the thing.
Oh, they had an autograph signing thing.
Oh, okay,
so I was part of a whatever.
Yeah.
So people were waiting and it was fun to, you know, meet people. But it's just strange that people recognize me from that show. And I think it's just because the darn thing's repeated so many times.
Yeah.
But then I found out they did. I was so flattered. I was like, really? They did a, I just thought, okay, people are recognizing me because they've just played it so many times,
right?
I'm being shoved down, you know, basically
or
just
they were kids and
constantly.
They,
yeah.
Sticks with you. Yeah.
Yeah. But then they did like a, some sort of vote. I guess they've done this a few times about the most popular characters.
Okay.
And I think I was like third and like this, the second one, the first one was like a duck or something. So I
don't know.
Like, so I'm like shocked by that. I'm like, well, that's fun.
It's
you know,
weird how you do this, you know, a gig for a couple days and then
one day,
years
I mean,
later,
you know, it shows one day and you think, you know, on that show for a week.
And years later, people are still.
I actually replaced Kathy Ireland.
Really?
It's a good bit of trivia, I guess.
I had no idea, because she was really pushing an acting career at that time.
She was, and I don't think she's hurting because she's made billions of dollars in her home fashion empire. Yeah. Home furnishings, right,
or something?
I guess, you know, her voice was just too high at the time, and she still has a high voice, but I know she went to work on that, and she's brought it down.
She had a real, like a normal range voice.
Yeah.
It was kind of like a, you know, like a...
Just really, I don't think she, you know, on sitcoms you have to be heard.
Yes.
You know, kind of almost like the theater, I guess, right?
Yeah.
So I think maybe they just couldn't hear her, you know?
That's possible.
But anyway.
That's interesting.
I'm so glad that I got to do that part. It was fun.
A friend of mine is Molly Hagan. I don't know if you know
Molly. No, I don't.
Molly's been in everything. She was on Herman's Head, and she's in Election.
Herman's
she's just,
Head. I haven't heard that in a long
time. Tons of shows. And she was shooting a thing in Boston, and my wife and I went out to dinner with her, and the waitress was like staring at her, and you know, she's like, oh, you know, what's it going to be? And, this girl was like maybe 22. She's like, were you in Friends? She's in One.
One. Yeah.
And she was like, yeah. And this was like everything. And I'm like, that's this generation of like, I know everyone
that's
is
fun.
In the show.
I know people like on my social media started posting from my episode of Friends and posting the picture of the TV. I thought, wow, they're showing it again.
Yeah.
And I still get great residuals from that show. It's crazy.
Yeah. It's on all the time.
Yeah. And network TV is great like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, in terms for actors, you get better residuals. You
right.
know?
Of course.
Yeah.
I think that was a window that closed too, sort of after that show where now it's hard.
It's
like
changed. It's definitely changed. Yeah, for sure.
About that show and Seinfeld, when we were talking about the technology,
mm-hmm.
is those both those shows were shot in widescreen for flat screen TVs that weren't out yet.
Oh, that's interesting.
So now when you watch them, you're seeing more picture. Because they're showing the whole picture, but they actually cropped them when they first aired because they were anticipating a move to HD. And
very
it
smart.
Didn't happen, you know, but they still shot them that
very
way.
Smart.
So sometimes I get
no
super
idea.
Nerdy if they're on it. I'm like, oh, wow, there's like a counter I've never seen. Yeah, it's ridiculous.
That would be a good trivia test you should do.
Like, what have you missed
yes,
on the screen?
Yes, yes.
Where are we? Thursday still? Anything else?
I did Merry Christmas with Julie Andrews.
Yes. I love this. The specials are just...
Yeah, they were great.
And the variety show, which we don't have anymore at this
point. Well, you know, you say that, but in a way, I mean, you know, you've got The Voice and you've
got Talent.
Are those shows kind of... Not really, but...
I guess they are. I guess the thing that I always associate with variety shows, especially this era, is an anchor personality.
Mm.
So they have hosts, but it's not like, you know, it's not the Tom Bergeron show.
Right.
You know, where you have like...
Donnie and Marie.
Donnie and Marie, or Pink Lady and Jeff, or the Bay City Rollers. Cher. Yeah, you know, the Sid and Marty Krofft puppets,
right.
or whatever it is. And those sort of gave it a like a different vibe.
Yeah.
Like you kind of knew, like, if it's a Mandrell sister,
right.
like, it's going to have a certain
they
thing.
They did get corny, right? I mean,
oh,
as we
God,
got older,
yeah,
they were corny.
Were.
Yeah.
But I think that was, I think everyone kind of recognized
everything was
it.
Corny back then,
yeah.
a little bit.
Yeah. Which people liked.
Yeah, they liked it.
Yeah. Or even the Brady Kids variety show. They had
yes!
Show, which was crazy. Like, oh, the Brady's fascinate me because sitcom, family, big hit. What do we do next? Give them a singing variety show. And then they had a cartoon. And then in 1990, they had a reboot that was a drama.
Did they really?
Yeah, called The Brady's 30-something was very popular.
Oh, I missed that one.
So they did a Christmas special and then a series where it was an hour-long drama about like the middle-aged Brady's and their struggles.
Right. Wow.
People weren't having that.
And now the reboots are really working.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think maybe because, you know, when you look... It hasn't changed that much, right? Like you were saying, like the look of things. I mean, even music, right? When we were growing up, we thought, my grandmother used to listen to like Frank Sinatra and
swing
Lawrence. Well,
yeah.
you know, it was just music you couldn't relate to. But
totally
now
different.
People are going like, yes, Led Zeppelin.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah. It's all the same.
The Eagles. It is. It's sort of all melded.
They
you
don't
know?
Delineate. Yeah. Generations.
Right. So it makes sense that the reboot can be here. And there was proven shows. You know, if I were an exec at a network, I'm going to green light the reboot because I know it's going to work pretty much.
Yeah.
You know, if they execute it well.
And things like Full House and like, I can't
Fantastic.
Believe how they did this.
Yeah.
Like,
it's so great.
It's great that you did this.
Yeah.
And it's funny when people complain about it because I'm like, we'll just only watch the other one. Like, just pretend it's not on if you're having a problem
with it.
Oh,
they have a problem with it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there's well, yeah, just don't watch the
they're like,
other
they're
one.
Ruining my, I'm like, just don't watch it.
Yeah.
They're not getting rid of the other
yes,
one.
Yes, you can still see it.
Still there.
And people seem to just be timeless now in the way they look.
Yes.
Everyone's like aging backwards.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah. Or like in the fashion doesn't seem, I mean, it's always difficult when you're in the middle of an era to recognize like the cliches in the fashion.
Yeah, but the 70s was.
But the 70s, yeah, stuff looks super 80s. Yeah,
even
90s,
the 80s. But the now, 90s, I guess the 90s fashion is so, it's still current. Yeah. I mean, I still have 90s. Not everyone wants 90s clothes.
But people could wear anything.
Yeah, in era, you wouldn't
and
know.
It's fine. Like, yeah. It doesn't. It's, I think we're just more permissive culturally when it comes to like that sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
where it's like that, like if, you know, in the 80s, if you dressed up like the 50s, they're like, the guy's a weird greaser. But now they're just like, hey, whatever.
Yeah. I have friends that wear like all 40s clothes all the time.
Yeah, and no one bats an eyelash now, which is kind of fantastic. And I also want to meet those friends.
Our favorite show is on Thursday night.
What do you got?
Barney Miller.
I love Barney
and soap.
Miller. Barney Miller. It just, it seemed to me so real seeming. And Hal Linden, I just loved Hal Linden.
Mm-hmm.
Because he wasn't like that omnipotent, like, I'll fix everything. Because a lot of times he was like, look, I don't know. But he was so sincere. And all the characters were so good.
You trusted him.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah. You trusted that he was going to do the right thing and kind of know what he was doing. And it's just, I love Dietrich. Is maybe my favorite character.
I don't remember.
He was Steve Ladisberg. He was the guy with the glasses who was just like really smart and always knew everything.
Remember that well.
And you had Abe Vigoda.
Yes. Is he still alive?
No, he died maybe a year or two ago, but he was like almost 100 years old. He was around a long time. And Jack Sue, who was me. That guy's life story is crazy. He was signed to Motown, and he's Japanese.
Incredible.
He was in one of the Japanese internment camps when he was a kid. He was in Flower Drum Song. Like, he was one of the groundlings.
Beautiful.
And then he's on Barney Miller. You know, they brought all this stuff. And that show I watch all the time. And the least current show fashion-wise, but the topics, it could be anytime.
Yeah, I'm going to go back and watch it.
It's really great.
It wasn't one, you know, I remember loving it. But it's not one that I said, I have to watch it now. You know, for me at that age, it was all about, you know, Happy Days and Laverne and Shirley.
Yeah.
But I remember watching it and really liking it. And I just thought, what was his name? Fish?
Yeah, Fish.
Abe Vigoda. Yeah.
Vigoda, yeah. And he was just so close to retirement and just so like, all right.
Every few years, I had a friend that would say, no, Abe Vigoda's dead. And I'm like, no, I think he's alive. And then he's alive. And a couple of years later, no, he died. Yeah, you're right. He died. No, he's alive.
It used to be a famous website that was like,
alive or dead?
Abe Vigoda. Specifically.
Oh, really?
It was like, is Abe Vigoda?
Also, it wasn't just me.
It wasn't just you. And he was in on it. Like, he thought it was funny. So, like, literally, you could go be like, is he? And you'd check. And like, nope, still alive. Because he had to be close to 100 years old.
And Soap was so brilliant.
Soap is tough because it's still good. But when you go back and watch it now, it's
really hard. I have to go back and watch.
It's hard to understand the context of the time it was airing.
I thought, okay, so again, for me at that time, I was a little girl. So, it was more about the Laverne and Shirley and Happy Days. But I remember it coming on. I remember my mother and my brother and watching this show that seemed to really push boundaries.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean,
Billy Crystal played a gay character.
Yes.
And yeah. It definitely.
It was the first time we saw, like, wasn't it the gay character?
They
were just insane.
It was crazy. There were aliens and the ventriloquist guy.
Weren't there this rich family?
Yes.
That,
yeah.
It was great to see crazy rich people.
Absolutely. It was like the Addams Family without the horror
yes.
element. And Catherine Hellman, so good.
So good.
And then Benson spun off from it, which is weird because it's the same character, but he's totally different.
And that did well, right?
6 seasons, yeah.
So now Soap was only on, what, two or three, right?
Yeah. But it's a weird show. Like, I think those sort of parodies of soap operas like Mary Hartman,
mm-hmm.
and Soap were too weird.
They were maybe too strange.
Someone got possessed by the devil on Soap. There was like an exorcism.
Yes. It was just off the wall.
Yeah. Crazy.
Yeah.
But it was a huge hit. And
I'm surprised it didn't last longer.
I feel like some of those shows that are so weird that become huge hits, most people's tolerance for it's really low. Like that happened with Twin Peaks. Like when that came on, I mean, that was the biggest thing in the world in 1990. But by midway through season two, it was like not even top 100.
Oh, really?
People just stopped caring immediately. There's like a, for most people, I think it's just like a weird novelty, and then they're like, eh. Mm. They get fickle very quickly.
Huh.
And the weird shows, tends to be.
I wonder if the, I wonder why that happens, do you think? I mean, do you think the writing went down in Twin Peaks, or do you think?
Twin Peaks was two things, I think. One, they, everyone was intrigued by the who killed Laura Palmer, because mm-hmm. everyone was a mystery. And when they solved that, people didn't care.
Mm.
And also, it was so innovative. There was nothing like it on TV that people were very intrigued. And then either once they got over the novelty of it, didn't care, or TV influence by it started coming out and it seemed less unique.
Mm.
So in the wake of Twin Peaks, we got Northern Exposure, which right. was like basically Twin Peaks without the horror element.
Mm-hmm.
Picket Fences. You know, there's a lot of sort of Wild Palms. Like, they were very similar.
I never heard of that, but you know, when shows. A show is good, I mean, something like Sopranos.
Yeah.
You know, it lasts. There's,
yeah.
People are, if that would have kept going on and they could have, you know, people would have still watched
I think HBO cracked the code a little bit where they weren't, because they weren't concerned about ratings. They were able to make a show that was different and they didn't have to change it along the way to keep people on board,
right.
which is like Deadwood
yeah.
and Sopranos. Huh. Whereas the network shows are like, we're losing people, do something.
Isn't that, I mean, the quality is just so fantastic now
yeah.
of
yeah.
of the content that's out there. It really is another
They let you tell level. A story now.
Yeah.
Like, you can be like, this is 13 episodes and I have a beginning, middle, and end.
Yes.
Which shouldn't be weird, but is. And mm-hmm. it's very satisfying to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But aside from the big miniseries events when we were growing up, you know, like North and South or something, you didn't generally get a satisfying ending in a TV
right.
show. Or it was too wrapped up quickly.
Right. I stopped, you know, when I met my husband, Nels Van yep. Patten, I really kind of stopped watching TV. During that time, I kind of missed that 1990, you know,
it was a
for
huge
several
transition.
Years.
Yeah.
I think about it, I thought, wait, why did that happen? And I just remember, you know, we would go out to dinner a lot.
Yeah.
And we would spend a lot of time with his family, too. So his father, Dick Van Patten, it was like the Van Patten family reality, like
yeah.
variety show, like every night.
You can't
like,
watch TV if it's not as good as
he was so much more entertaining than yeah. anything on TV, you know. Why would you even want to turn on the TV?
Exactly.
You know, he had us in stitches like every single minute. So, but I do, I'm really grateful now to be able to go back and watch some, like just watching Cheers now,
yeah.
You know, for the first time and being able to watch
it
some
is
of those
cool.
shows.
Like catching up on that, being able to catch up on that stuff.
Or The West Wing I just watched.
Yeah. yeah. Or like X-Files or like shows that I kind of tried to follow, but like X-Files was one that I liked, but then I was like in a band and I was out.
Yeah.
I would miss it.
Right.
You know, and I'm like, oh, now I could go, you know, watch them all.
Okay. So you're such, I just have to ask this question before
yes.
we end, but you're so incredible with the trivia, right?
Oh.
You seem to know everything, right? So how do you do it now? Because there's so many shows. I mean, can you really keep up? Do you try to keep up with everything?
I tried to for a bit and I cannot.
You just can't.
So I've found that there's a lot, especially since doing the show, there's a lot of shows that I either rediscovered or didn't really know that much about that I've gone back and watched. So a lot of the time I'm like, I'm catching up on old stuff. Like, I'm like, Car 54 Where Are You is the greatest show ever. You know, like I'm watching shows from the 60s.
Right. Oh, I love that.
But I tend to watch self-contained shows that are like one storyline that I'm like, this is only 8 episodes and I know that it'll have a beginning, middle, and an end.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't watch very many like comedies or I'll watch like British ones that are only 6 episodes, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely have, part of it I think is my contrarian nature, and part of it is what we were talking about earlier where I'm like, it seems like it's gonna be tough,
too hard. Yeah,
the stuff everyone's watching, I've never mm-hmm. seen Game of Thrones, I've never watched The Walking Dead. You know, like I just, it's not like I'm like, oh, everyone's watching, but I'm like, yeah, I'll get to it eventually.
Well, Game of Thrones is quite a commitment, so
yeah.
I haven't gone there yet.
I haven't either. I'll have to finish it. Yeah.
Exactly.
And there are shows that I'll start watching, and I'm like, I hate this. Now I have to watch 400 more episodes, because like I started it, you know? Or shows that were airing every week that I like couldn't give up, even though I didn't really like the show anymore. Like, I used to watch Supernatural every week, and it's been off like 13 seasons, and I just really stopped enjoying it like season 9, but I'm like,
you can't turn it off.
I'm like, well, I can't give up on, I mean, they'll know. You know, it's just like I've stuck with them so long.
Oh, that's funny.
You know, not as acquainted.
Sometimes you just have to break up with them.
I broke up with them eventually, and you know, I think we're both better off for it now. But yeah, it's hard. It's hard. And but you don't, the immediacy isn't there. So I know that if I miss something, I can always watch it again.
Yes.
Which is the difference, I think, from when we were growing up, where you were like, you have to make the choice if you're going to watch this or not. And if you're not, you're never going to.
Mm-hmm.
And now you can't.
How can you see it? Yeah. I remember when 24 was out, and I didn't get, you know, really turned onto it until I forget what season it was. And then I got obsessed with it.
Yeah.
And I actually went into an editing house that I work with and said, you know, they told me, like, yeah, we have that season. Nancy, you can come in anytime. Yeah. And I literally I watched the entire season because I was so addicted, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I was working with them anyway, so it was sort of convenient, but
you like, you know, made your own Netflix.
Yes, I made my own Netflix. So yeah. I don't miss waiting. I love the instant gratification of it.
I mostly do too, but it was kind of nice as like a...
It made an event. It made a special, you know, event.
I miss the event of it. And like, you know, you'd have people over to watch the finale or that kind of stuff. And especially someone who's never been into sports, which tends to be the big thing.
I agree.
You miss those things.
I was so not into sports that when the football game came on a Saturday, I was like, so depressed. I was like,
what am I
going to
do
now?
And I felt... Everyone was so into it, and I'm like, I wish I got this. It just doesn't seem fun.
Yeah, it made me feel alone and, you know, kind of not part of society, but getting married to my husband, who's such a jock, really helped in that way.
Yeah,
because he's he knows everything. He's like a human encyclopedia of sports, so he always takes over that part of the conversation. Yes, he's got this.
I remember when I was a teenager, I had to have decoy sports teams to say I liked if I was like, if I had to talk to like a girlfriend's dad.
Pretend that you were in the know.
So I always went with Pittsburgh teams.
Oh, I love that.
They never hated them, but they didn't know anything about them. So they'd be like, who's your team? And I'd be like, oh, Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
And they'd be like, how are they doing? And I'm like, you know. And then they would just be like, yeah. And I'd be like, oh, God. Because otherwise they'd be like, I don't know.
I totally relate.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I feel your pain on that one.
That was a good effort, though.
Thank you.
I like that.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
There you go. That's Nancy. How great is she? Really enjoyed talking to her. You probably know her from Loverboy or possibly The Heavenly Kid. She's been in a ton of things. Couldn't be nicer. Really love talking to her. As I said, that Baywatch documentary, as soon as I know anything more about it, I will obviously talk about it here because I am a huge fan. Thanks to everyone who wrote in and enjoyed last week's episode with Russ Woody. His book is great. I heard from many of you who bought it and read it since then. Fairly quick read, or you're very fast readers. Thanks to everyone who came and said hello to me in Reno. I am wading through my audio from that, so there should be some upcoming things from Reno Pop Culture Con. That was great. Hadn't been in Nevada, as I said every week, and there's some cool stuff there. The bowling alley from, it's not even an alley, it's the bowling museum arena from Kingpin, speaking of Vanessa Angel. That was really, really cool to see. I put up pictures on the social media if you want to check that out. Speaking of social media, I am at TV Guidance on both Instagram and Twitter, at Kenneth W. Reed on both, as well as tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or kennethwreed@gmail.com, which is my real email address that I accidentally just gave out again, although the other ones are real, but Ken at iCanRead. Really just email me wherever you want. It's fine. It's fine. I'm not worried. We'll be here next week, so I hope you will too, for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Yeah.
It was great to see crazy rich people.
Absolutely.